great to join you all here in real life, IRL, to discuss art, architecture, and this phenomenon of the metaverse. After so much Zoom and online portals over the last 2 years, it sometimes feels like we've already entered this thing, the metaverse. And at the same time, the concept is still really quite murky, and we want to wade into that murky water a little bit. So just what is it? Is it a game or something out of Ready Player One or Tron? Or is it a space for commerce, an NFT, it's an online shopping? Or maybe it's a collective space for creativity, like a digital Burning Man? The big question, however, for all of us today is how might artists and architects give shape to this new spatial phenomenon? So Neal Stephenson coined the term metaverse in 1992 in his novel Snow Crash. You all probably know a little bit about that. But I think it's William Gibson's description of cyberspace, which is really a synonym for metaverse, which is quite evocative. In 1989, in Neuromancer, Gibson wrote, and I'll tell you in a second, that cyberspace is a consensual hallucination, a graphical representation of data abstracted from the banks of every computer in the human system, of unthinkable complexity, lines of light ranged in the non-space of the mind, clusters and constellations of data like city lights receding. It kind of sounds like LA. So I'm really excited that we have a fantastic panel lined up to answer my questions, this big question. We have Refik, Lara, and Friedrich, and Liam. Welcome, everybody. We're going to start right in the middle with Refik. Everybody's going to give us a short presentation, and then we'll have a general dialogue.
Thank you very much. So great to be here. Hello, everyone. And so wonderful to see friends in the physical world, finally. I think, here 2 years ago for another Frieze LA, and great to be here. I'm a media artist, director, living and working in Los Angeles, California, and was last 10 years with my team. We are 15 people, can speak 15 languages, represent 10 countries, and trying to practice with, data as a substance. 2008, I'm still searching for the origins and coined the term data painting. I was trying to understand the idea of using numbers as the form of the memories and to the algorithms. And 2016 was a fortunate collaboration with Google and became one of the first generation AI artists that was able to learn how to use machine learning algorithms to create experiences. But always the dream was, if it was a video was running, so the idea was always, I think, obsessed by the idea of embedding media arts into architecture. I think tonight the questions are very relevant. The dream was one day, the buildings will be beyond just concrete, steel, and glass, and this gravity will be beyond what we can imagine, and the data and the memories and the machines, potentially creativity can become a part of a substance that is most likely a light that can compute. As a team, we are trying to seriously understand the impact of ego on data and try to detach ego from data and work with collective memories, specifically not detached to the Web 2 world of profiles and like privacy and free will problems, and go beyond them and try to find a meaningful engagement in public space, which is art for anyone, any age, and any background. And I guess today is very meaningful because I think NFTs or blockchain is a mean of like public art, where I hope the inclusive experiences in art and culture can be more meaningful. And also, I think the power of public art, I found that when it is beyond just the gallery and museum of the 21st century imagination, there's a much powerful context of culture, social impact, and many other discourse and contexts. And so as a studio, we are doing our very best to create those novel experiences pretty much on the shoulders of many giants and understanding the discourse through the history and try to predict the future by inventing some tools and experiences. By the way, the immersive storytelling, I think if we have a moment to share today, like almost a decade, heavily focused on that medium, and I think where the metaverse keyword has a different meaning, hopefully we can discuss also. Very excited. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Refik. Why don't we pause this video here to our booth back there, and I'll turn the mic over to Lara and Friedrich from Space Popular to take it away and give an insight into their practice.
Thank you. Thanks, Mimi. Yeah, I am Lara Lismes.
And I'm Frederick Helberg. Difficult to follow after Refik, but do our best. Thanks so much. So we are Space Popular. We are architects, but we operate mainly within the sort of world of the overlap of virtual environments for the past 10 years. And we have done quite a lot of exhibitions where we build physical elements, big sculptures that are experienced in a hybrid form through virtual reality headset in what we call spatial essays. And we're interested in the experience of space and have worked with projects where we're exploring sort of the possibility of non-Euclidean spaces and the possibility of architecture bending beyond its recognizable forms, where it's much more about the identity of ourselves and how we connect to the spaces we're experiencing. We have also done a lot of work and continue to do a lot of work about processing complex sets of data with our first project, the Cloud Resilience, over 10 years ago, trying to create a global mortality rate database that could be experienced through virtual means, and also the kind of idea of a first virtual funeral setting.
And we have also worked with several archives. We enjoy working with archives because it gives us access to large sets of data. And we enjoy thinking about how, through immersive media, one could give access to the overview of something really complex, like an archive, and at the same time give access to stories and narratives to engage with, and give access to zoom-ins and detail. We are currently working with a new archive that we are actually, this one we are building ourselves. It doesn't exist. And it relates to what you are seeing in the screen right now, which is magical and virtual portals and the history of them throughout fiction, both in literature and cinema. And we are trying to understand, as architects, what is this new architectural element, the portal, and how can we imagine it now that we are going to be able to actually step through it. So perhaps we can leave it right there.
All right. Thank you. This is great. Okay, I'm starting to see overlaps between these sort of different divergent practices, and let me give it over to Liam and see what else we find here.
Right. I did a whole film and storytelling thing, so this is going to be much longer than both of your presentations. I apologize, but it's locked in the system now, so we're going to sit through it. So I guess what could be described as a speculative architect, but what that really means is that I don't design buildings, but rather I make films, I build imaginary worlds for the entertainment industry. But really, I tell stories about the architectural or urban or global implications of emerging technologies. And what I try and do normally is frame my little talks as not as PowerPoint presentations or slideshows, but as kind of illustrated narratives or sort of sci-fi storytelling safaris. So I thought in my 5 minutes, what I was going to try and do was to give us some context for the conversation by giving us a few little stories from behind the scenes of the metaverse. So maybe we can play the video and we'll try and get there. So these are some of the worlds that we create, whether it be for my own films or for world building for the film and TV industry. We use fictional worlds as a space to prototype important ideas. And we think about making these new worlds of the metaverse. And in doing so, what I want to try and do is to take us through the screen a little bit and beyond the fog of the cloud to explore a whirlwind tour on this other side of the metaverse. To not focus on the digital, but to explore the real people and real places that exist on the other side. So we're going to go on a little tour for the next 5 minutes, and our first stop here, our first footprints are out on the uneven distance edges of the metaverse, and we crunch through the salt flats of the lithium triangle in South America. This is the electric earth that will power the metaverse. Almost all of the world's lithium resources are buried here, the key ingredient in all of the batteries that power said metaverse. The indigenous population that belong to this land tell this amazing creation story of lithium. They talk about the tears and breast milk of mythic volcanoes that have mixed together to form this lithium lake. And this massive mining landscape carved out of one of the rarest and most precious ecologies on the world is the geology that's enacted when we step into the metaverse and wander the digital fields. It's a landscape hidden behind the glare of the pixel, but when talking about the metaverse, we must remember that it is powered essentially by the breast milk of mythic volcanoes. And for our next stop, what I want to take us to is the beating and purring heart of the metaverse, where we're going to explore the data centers of Mark Zuckerberg's Facebook data center. And here, we're endlessly scanned by countless sensors and gyros and lasers that feed the meta system operating. And it's optimizing and customizing our experiences. And the flickering LEDs that we pass on our tour like little fireflies are actually tiny reflections of each of us buzzing around within someone else's marketing portfolio. So perhaps a question we might think about is, are we citizens or customers of the metaverse? And in this film, we've developed a new choreography that distorts our silhouette and disguises the proportions of our body so as to evade the same body detection algorithms that's used by the metaverse cameras. We've developed this new vocabulary of movement that is exuberant in plain sight, but through the eyes of the meta machines, two bodies become one, entangled with fractured limbs and fuzzy frames and lost connections. It's a new but necessary way that we might hack out private spaces or intimate moments amongst the meta clouds where everything will need to be tracked within millimeter precision. And these same tracking algorithms are required to enact our fantasy of gesture-controlled futures. Like the exaggerated mimes of silent movies, soon we will dance and jig our interfaces to life. We can't have one of these metaverse futures without the other. These are some of our augmented reality interfaces that we were visual consultants for on the Apple Plus film Swan Song. This is the future that the metaverse promises us. Skylines filled with digital confetti of our desired world, somehow projected just for us. But in our final stop on this short little tour, I want to journey through the metaverse to visit the renderlands and the CGI farms of the entertainment and gaming industry. Because in events like this, on rooftops like this, we're actually really wandering the luxury aisles of the metaverse, the Christie auctions and the seductive 360 awe of NFTs. But really the suburbs of the metaverse, the everyday infrastructure that will populate it, are actually made here, away from the gaze of collectors in India and Indonesia, across the other side of the planet, where a massive anonymous workforce are crafting the high-fidelity digital architectures of video games and blockbusters, and soon, of course, the metaverse. So this is our film, Renderlands. And in the film, we meet Prakash, a render farm worker who's making and shaping the digital worlds that we all inhabit. And Prakash has fallen in love with the digital model of a beautiful Hollywood actress after spending his 14 hours a day endlessly rotoscoping and rendering her into the metaverse. He's lovingly airbrushed across every pore on her face, every strand of her hair, as he 3D models her superhero silhouette scene by scene, day by day. And by night, when the fluorescents are switched off and everyone else has gone home, he straps on his VR goggles and they walk hand in hand through the streets of a metaverse he's collaged together for them from scavenged VFX movie models and 3D game assets. And while we inhabit this digital utopia that exists in the thickness of the screen, in reality, the metaverse stretches from Los Angeles to Bangalore. It's a world of digital labor and content moderators and data processing and digitally simulated actors and our outsourced pixel projected dreams. So at the end of our tour, as we rip off our headsets and AR lenses, perhaps we could say in the conversation that the metaverse is not necessarily going to be a late capitalist Zuckerbergian fever dream. But at the same time, neither is it going to be an escapist utopian fantasy or flat world without the systemic horrors of the real. In a way, it'll be both of these things, because no technology has ever really been a solution to anything. It really just exaggerates the conditions that exist. So the metaverse will be equal parts fear and wonder, because in the end, so are we. And I guess I want to start with these kind of stories because they're stories we must tell, imagining the multiverse of metaverses So that we might somehow scaffold the versions that we want, not the one that can be most appropriately sold to us. There'd be monsters in the metaverse, but while the pixels are still gooey and its form is fluid, the more we imagine the intended and unintended consequences it sets in motion, the places where they might dwell get that little bit smaller. That's it.
Thank you, Liam, and thank all of you for sort of giving us this first glimpse into this verse. I don't know. I don't even know if it's meta at this point. But I maybe want to ask us to think about donning those goggles back on for a second. And, you know, asking, Liam, we got a bit from you, sort of your point of view on what this metaverse may or may not be and kind of some of the hazards that we'll encounter along the way. But Refik and Frederick and Lara, I want to sort of ask you to jump in a little bit about how do you go about imagining this metaverse? I think of it it's like you put on the VR goggles and it's a big black void and it has to sort of build itself. So what is the role for designers jumping into it?
I think one important thing to mention, at least from our point of view, is that, and this might kind of throw a blanket over a lot of the things that we might say, is that the term that we're kind of joining here today, metaverse, we've actually kind of resisted over many years not to use that word because it speaks for something new, something imagining that we'll eventually get there, or it's something new and exciting,
or that it's a product,
that it's something you can buy or something you can own, and we choose to instead call it the immersive internet, and it's actually just a three-dimensional version of the internet. Many of the things, which means that the kind of processes of a lot of these things that we are going to experience, they are kind of already there, and it might then seem like not quite as exciting, and actually, to some degree, that's probably quite helpful, because the sort of fever dream we find ourselves in right now, where this imagination, this space that most of us has never experienced, most people on Earth have never worn a VR headset. That's also not really what it's about. So that's not the end game or the sort of final gate, I think. So having said that, I think that the process of designing it, we design virtual architecture for our own films, our installation, but also sometimes for clients. And those processes can be extremely interesting, but they relate to obviously creative processes that go beyond what might be called the metaverse.
I mean, I think I had this very funny discussion and a meaningful discussion with Paolo Antonelli, and she was calling it a bananaverse during our MoMA collaboration for an NFT project, where the term and its discourse context completely is a very type of imagination that's still like untouchable and that kind of thing. But I think in that dialogue, what I felt that, I mean, I think anyone in the world, any technology we can invent and feel and touch and be a part of it has ramifications, right? And these ramifications are like comes in the very first top layer of like an oil and water kind of connection. But I think the more we, I think, feel about metaverse and think, I feel like it's like an art, right? Art for me is humanity's capacity of imagination. And that imagination can take any form, any shape, any material. And I think metaverse, a verse that can be imaginable, can be that form. That's, I think, very fun to start. But then we have the Web 2 problems, right? The world right now, we are all profiled somewhere on Earth, and like we are all like predictable, like hardware, software systems, like knows where we go, what we eat, where we like can predictably read and see and feel. I think that kind of profile in the cloud is most likely 21st century imagination, right? And I think the Web 3 and eventually metaverse has a potential to be like detaching the profile culture and maybe bringing like the anonymity first of all. And when the character and the being becomes a being beyond that, I guess, clouds of imagination and past data memories, we have something very fresh. So I think we are starting something very fresh. And I think also, I believe metaverse is not jumping something only virtual. I do believe it's something where the physical and the virtual meets. A human mind, an object, a feeling, a discourse, a narrative. Something is not only in the just blockchain. And I think that's where it gets much inspiring suddenly. I'm a protagonist and very optimist about humanity, that we will do things better than what we are doing last. But so I have much hope than fears, I guess.
We've got a lot of optimists out there. Lim, you want to jump in a little bit?
As in, like, the pessimist view? No, I'm a techno-optimist, actually. Like, I just think technology is complicated, and it just kind of serves to really exaggerate a lot of the underlying things that already exist. And I think we've got to figure out a lot of that stuff before we full-on dive into the metaverse, right? Like, I mean, yes, like, you know, the data footprints that come with Web 2.0, I feel like only get exaggerated when you start to capture full bodies, and that's what, you know, the camouflage choreography project I showed was trying to talk about. But questions over who owns that data, privacy within the metaverse, like, these are still things we haven't figured out. To be honest, we're still in the middle of the court case for Kim.com and file sharing, you know? Like, we still haven't figured out Napster, and now we're talking about the metaverse. Like, it's all it's going to do is make those problems more explicit, I think. At its core, though, it has the potential to be fundamentally a new set of systems and infrastructures that can totally change the landscape. The worry is that it's just operationalized in the service of the same people who have monetized Web 2.0, and it doesn't become that, but it really could. The potential of these systems can totally change the nature of how communities are formed and shaped, how artist practices work, like yours has been transformed across the last 2 years. And there's real opportunity and excitement there, but there's also incredible, incredible danger.
Now, I think something that came up in your talk and sort of Tommy said is we have ideas of being a consumer, ideas of being a citizen, ideas of being a being, right? And I maybe want to sort of lean into that being just a little bit, because it, you know, suggests a kind of physicalization or a projection of these bodies into some other spatial condition. And I think what's interesting about the metaverse is that, are we replicating, you know, all conditions? Are we replicating gravity? Like, what, you know, what's the free-for-all, and how does a designer or an artist start to kind of get legs within this new spatial condition?
I think perhaps to pick up on something specific that I'd really enjoy that Refik said, you spoke about this notion of like your persona becomes its own and sort of gets this promise of starting afresh. where I think it is interesting to think about that. However, it feels like when things stop feeling like a game, the moment they become real, no, is and they therefore become meaningful, is when they become inseparable from us. And I think the same applies to the notion of the avatar, it being like I really start caring about my avatar, be that my profile in social media or be that my profile in some social VR that is also attached to some kind of 3D form of myself. That starts to become really meaningful when I don't feel I can change it every 5 seconds, right? Or when I feel like I have stakes on it. Meaning, I don't know, people recognize me, and therefore I'm starting to develop relationships that are going to be attached to that identity. I think in a perhaps a slightly more abstract way, the same notion applies to perhaps things, virtual things or virtual enclosures, we may call it virtual spaces, virtual architecture and design. And therefore I think every time we try and design something, I feel like it's never something new. It's always, of course, something that is based on all the baggage that you carry and all the things that we are sort of creating together. And therefore, I think being quite aware of those very specific references that we plant in virtual worlds in order to create spaces that convey a certain degree of meaning is perhaps a good starting point to actually embrace the fact that it's going to be referential. As architects, we are very often confronted with the question of, like, why would it look like? Why would you have things that look like reality? And it's like, well, what do you know that doesn't look like reality to start with? And what would it happen if you try and create the least relatable version ever? No, how do we even begin? So, well, I just wanted to put that out there.
Well, I know that you're working on a project that has to do with these portals, and I'm really sort of intrigued about, you know, this threshold, right? Like the threshold of a portal, the threshold of going from one spatial condition of the physical to another spatial condition of the virtual. And I wonder if you can say a little bit something to this idea of like the architectural framework of a portal, or and just what does that do for us when you move into a more virtual space?
Yeah, this idea comes from a very basic question of thinking like, well, if moving from a web page to another was basically clicking on that blue text underlined, no, those hyperlinks, when you have to switch between one three-dimensional space to another, and this is not contained within the frame of your screen anymore, you very quickly are confronted with the issue of how do you create that transition, right? So, of course, it's like, okay, everything can turn black, and then you get the new world. And what does that really mean, or what does that convey? Which is, again, it gives you a sense that, like, okay, anything that is here could disappear any minute. Anything that is here is not correlated to my physical reality. I cannot rely on anything that is here because it could be gone, right? So I think that's why probably we see in the history of portals in fiction that we have been looking at all the ways from Alice in Wonderland and Narnia to the whatever the latest, I don't know, or like portal games and the latest things that we are seeing in fiction. We see this sort of frame or a vehicle, something that you get into and you come out in a new place. However, all of this usually come in the form of locks or closed doors with keys. And again, I feel like all of that is conveying a certain narrative, not too different from the affordances in buildings, no? And these elements can be more inviting or less so by design. In our research, we're trying to really look through how these devices, how portals have been used to support which narratives, and trying to start to think about what would we think is a good portal, meaning like what is an inviting portal, what is a portal that is also giving you enough information about the space you are entering, what is a virtual portal that is telling me what is going to be the surveillance mechanism in the world that I'm accessing, what will be my role, who owns it, what is it linked to. And so that made us start to think about these portals made of fabric, virtual fabric, that potentially could give you information of this very complex, knitted network of the internet, and at the same time is perhaps a curtain, is a veil and not a door, no? And is inviting you to go in while signaling that there is a threshold.
And Liam, like, narrative is also your jam, and I think one of the kind of amazing things about the work that you do is the way that you make it so immersive and visceral. I was watching your TED Talk about Planet City, and you're talking about the smell of hard drives as well as the smell of rotting fruit. And I was wondering if you can maybe talk about some of the tools that you use to kind of build this sense of immersiveness.
Yeah, I guess they're just traditional tools from writing, I suppose. I mean, I'm interested in the tactility of what we think about as ephemeral media, I suppose. Maybe that's one way to tackle your question. I mean, I love to talk about the smell of the internet. I've spent a ridiculous amount of time in giant warehouses filled with servers, which is actually the real site of the metaverse, right? The metaverse isn't out there in the clouds. It's someone's computer in a room plugged into a wall, running off power. And to try and ground this discourse of the digital in the realities of its physical presence is something that we try and talk about a lot. I'm interested in like co-opting the language from romantic poetry that might normally talk about rolling hills or daffodils and use it to talk about server farms and Facebook's data center or hydroelectric power, you know. The attempt there is to try and bring people into these spaces in a whole range of different ways, not just through the forms through which they're marketed to us, which generally is to try and take away the idea of any sort of physicality. You know, the language that we use to describe, you know, the MacBook Air or even the notion of the cloud, like, it's all a nomenclature that's been invented to try and disguise the fact that these systems are actually rooted in ground and landscape. And I guess any form of immersion for me needs to also acknowledge the physical as well as the digital. It's another question point, I guess, but I'm really interested in, like, what happens when you turn the metaverse off. You know, in a world of XR, AR, VR, whatever we want to call it, when so much of our experience and ornament and life becomes digital, you know, essentially each one of us can be tuned to our own architectural or urban channels. You know, like, you know, I'm pretending to sit here talking to you, but my augmented reality contact lens has the next episode of Station 11 up there, and I'm actually watching that in the background. Or, you know, I've downloaded a digital skin. I'm a Man United fan, and LA right now looks like, you know, a Man United fan would want it to look like. We can all be existing in these parallel realities. But when you turn all that off, what is left behind of the physical? Has the world been reduced to a sort of a green screen stage set that's just kind of lying in wait, ready for the premiere of a million animated movies? I don't know, but, like, when we talk about immersion, I think that idea of how the physical and the digital are actually fundamentally tied together in really interesting ways is something we should talk about.
Yeah, and I see Refik nodding, and I maybe want to have him take up that point, but also, you know, I think a lot of your practice has been around collective memory, not necessarily just the individual and their relationship to virtual worlds, but what happens when all of this ties together. So maybe if you can touch a little bit on, pick up and then touch on that.
Yes, by the way, incredible points. I mean, the portals, and by the way, Lim, your data dramatization was an incredibly inspiring point too. Like, back in 2015, I guess, I was just really finding incredibly powerful that, like, actually data is a form of dramatization that can take any shape and forms. I mean, when I think about data, like the Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, brain signals, like watches, like everything around us can have a, you know, meaning from a different perspective. So thank you for that again, and I think that was a very... And the portals, I guess, the immersive environments where the physical and virtual truly connects. But I think I have, like, four really exciting last year's memories that I think can be relevant to share. In Hong Kong, which is really unexpectedly very pandemic project, I couldn't fly. We had a project in Hong Kong, an immersive room, that people can go step inside this environment where the ceiling, floor, and the walls are completely... media and a LED screen. And in this project, the idea was like stepping into the mind of a machine, specifically the telescopes around the world, the Mars and the Hubble telescope, hopefully retiring respectfully, using the memories of these machines to reconstruct a narrative. And it was very, I find it actually very naturally connected that when the idea itself is already born in the mind of a machine, became a pixel and voxel, I found that the narrative between that imagination to the metaverse was so naturally connected. And I think I found that many creators practicing in a similar mindset found a true connection there. Of course, anyone can practice their physical ritual or any medium, but there was something very naturally connected. And the second one was, and that project was also like on the shoulders of like Kusama and like many pioneers of immersive rooms like the James Turrell's and Light and Space Movement. But what was exciting is minting the immersive room as a piece of experience was a really fresh thinking. And also the piece with MoMA collaboration again, it was really fundamental to imagine like the memories of an institution bravely taking a step in to discuss and understand the medium and the discourse itself was very powerful. And I found it profoundly changing us and reading from their perspectives what does metaverse means for an institution collecting one of the world's most important memories, 200,000 beautiful artworks in the world, and what an AI can dream about that, and how can we contextualize this in the form of a data sculpture or painting. It was really powerfully engaging and exciting. And the other project was in Art Basel Miami. It was a really challenging installation in the Miami Beach where we were able to install a data sculpture I guess, in the nature, the best museum in the world, most likely. And it was also very inspiring. Like a public art NFT was a powerful narrative where people can enjoy it in a physical space where the origins are in the blockchain. But the interface was next to a beautiful Miami beach where you can meditate to sunrise or sunset, but you can still feel it and you can still engage, meditate, or connect with it. And lastly, in Berlin, in Koenig Gallery in St. Agnes, a former brutalist architecture, a former church, it was a very inspiring project because we were able to put like a media architecture inside this beautiful structure used for religious context. And people were right now waiting in the queue for 1 kilometer and watching AI dreaming nature. And the piece was also in the blockchain. And it was just feels very sci-fi, like in your amazing narratives, like seeing people waiting in the queue, former church, looking AI dreaming was very excitingly hopeful in a positive way again.
And I guess I want to maybe, I got a high sign for about 5 more minutes. I want to throw in one more question before we need to, this went very fast. There's so much to talk about here. But I want to talk a little bit about what it means to be a maker at this point, because Liam and Lara and Frederick, you come from architecture. Refik, you come out of art. You know, these are practices that really talk about sort of solitary geniuses and you know, sort of the mind of the, you know, right? Okay, right. And maybe let's talk a little bit about how this changes our understanding of these design, of what it means to be a designer or an artist with, you know, with kind of collectivity?
I think actually the context of your work is really interesting in this regard, because you more than perhaps us, more than most artists, work with the tools really to be kind of the other half of the creative process in such an incredible way. And that's certainly the case with us too, or with anyone who creates for these things that kind of maybe take for granted the sort of how intertwined you are with the tools that you're using, actually how kind of long time it takes also to learn how to use them, which speaks for something that we think is at the core of maybe where we're heading. We often speak of the sort of maybe 20, 30 years process where we will reach a point where we can create architecture at the speed of the spoken word, where at the moment we see people using the metaverse and they change their avatar to maybe just make a joke, or if the subject changes in the discussion, then everyone changes their avatar, and the avatar becomes part of the language, and the next steps will probably be part of with using artificial intelligence and other tools where also the furniture and eventually the architecture becomes part of the expression, and as that speeds up, then eventually your words will materialize in the architecture as well. And that really speaks for like a creative process where like you're just the kind of the sort of starting point, and then the ripples of the complex kind of system then does the rest. But it would be super interesting to hear your thoughts around this, because standing in front of one of your art pieces, it's just the mesmerizing quality is really incredible.
Thank you so much. I mean, same for wonderful inspirations on the body of work. And I think I want to maybe just take something I don't want to forget about the community. And I know this word is very much heard about in the NFT space and blockchain, but I think it's really very interestingly always there for the humanity, the community itself. But now, as a being, that community itself changing the form from a physical world like Discord channels and the servers and the social media engagements, it's becoming a whole new type of thinking and sharing. While respectfully, physical world incredible, but the amount of information exchanged completely happening literally in the cloud somewhere you mention, literally there. So how we can imagine an experience that we cannot touch but becomes a memory at the end? And to me, what makes, I think, all of us very responsible is like, how can we connect that dots in a purposeful way? But also, I feel like, as an artist, I think these technologies have ramifications. Like, I think we have a 50-50 chance, most likely, like in a subatomic, like, quantum computation level. But I think also the chance of what does it mean to be a human in the first century question is exactly tied into these potential actions. And I think, to me, if art can touch mind and soul at the same time, has a massive potential. And I think this technology and this type of imagination has one of those rare chances. So I hope everyone can try to create, share, and be a part of it.
Liam, I don't want to give you the last word here tonight.
Well, that sounds dangerous. Yeah, I mean, I think one of the opportunities here is to, I mean, I think NFTs are obviously super interesting and really potent right now, but there's also things like community tokens and other forms of coin that exist on chains that actually aren't about commodifying but are about connecting. And I think that feels to me much more transformative because, you know, I think, you know, Refik and I are longtime friends and a massive fan of his work, but you know, those kinds of experiences are at the very tip of what the metaverse will be. And there's huge swathes of the rest of it, which is made in like render farms, like we've been talking about in terms of makers. It you know, that's really the reality of what a lot of this space will be. To talk about it only within the kind of NFT context is like talking about the global shipping industry by examining a Louis Vuitton handbag. You know, so I think we need to acknowledge, you know, the forms through which digital labor currently exists, and that's you know, currently locked up within, you know, the Google, Apple, Amazon, Facebook stack, and what these forms of blockchain enabled processes mean is that we can see glimpses around that process, where we can start to, you know, at the moment, Web 2.0 versions of me, I have a Twitter profile, an Instagram profile, and everything. None of those things are owned by me. I use them and I curate them, but they're not me. But, you know, tokens that allow me to own my identity and to move it around the various platforms is fundamentally shifting what it means to be today and fundamentally changing the nature and structures of power and economies. And I think that's the extraordinary potential here.
And I think, you know, one of the questions I maybe wanted to start at with, had to do with, you know, is this metaverse a civic space? And with it comes all of the, you know, conditions of the real world, of all of the publics that need to be, you know, in contest in that civic space. But I won't get into that right now. Thank you, Liam, Refik, Frederick, so Lara.
We'll be together.
And thank you all. We'll see you downstairs for a drink.